So first, we will talk about integration in general. How important is your integration chapter, and how many concepts will directly be linked to your understanding of integration? Okay. So integration as a chapter itself, how important is it? Integration. So if you just talk about the overview of the integration chapter, we will be talking about two types of integration. One is indefinite. Okay. Indefinite integrals. Okay. In this particular chapter, you are mostly going to learn the process of integration. So it's a process-driven chapter. Okay. So what is the raw process? What is the methods that we use to integrate different types of functions? Okay. And we are going to basically talk about how, when a function is integrated, what does it give rise to? Okay. So what is the integral? What is the area function? And how do we find out by different tricks and tactics and procedures? So mostly that will be covered under indefinite integral. Okay. So today we'll be starting with this chapter itself. So by this, we'll be learning how to find area function, or you can say primitive, okay, or antiderivative, whatever. Many books call it as antiderivative. Some books will call it primitive. Some books will call it as the area function. The second chapter, which is directly linked to integration, is definite integrals. Definite integrals or definite integration. This chapter is property driven. Okay, because the process will be already known to you, right? So the process, you would have already learned all the processes in your indefinite integral. So what are you learning new indefinite integral? Nothing, but you are going to learn certain properties by which you are going to actually find area, okay, or area related, you can say, expressions. Okay, so this is linked to area. I would not say exactly area, it is linked to area. Okay, those who have done definite integrals in your school, you would know that this is mostly driven by some certain set of properties. Next chapter, which is directly linked, is your application of integrals. Application of integrals. And in this, we are going to basically talk about area under curves. So this chapter is actually the one where you are calculating the area between two curves. And in the previous chapter, which is definite integrals, you are going to evaluate area related integrals. So the integrals which are basically related to area. Okay. Both are different things to a certain extent. Okay. So we'll talk about that in our application of integrals. And lastly, we have differential equations. Okay. In this chapter, we are going to talk about the combination of your understanding of differentiation and, of course, integration. So basically, it's the time to involve now solving equations which are based on differential coefficients. Okay. So dy by dx, dy by dx square, or the derivative of any dependent variable with respect to independent variable, when you form a equation out of it, how do we basically form the equation first of all, and how do we basically solve those equations? That will be covered under differential equation. Now, very important aspects of, you can say, engineering and physics. In fact, in chemistry also, differential equation is used, and of course we are going to talk about it in our maths as well, how to solve this. Differential equations is going to play a very, very heavy role in your undergrad topics also. So I remember in electrical engineering, we had a lot of application of differential equations, and mostly like solving of circuits, etc., we use differential equations a lot. Of course, we convert it to a simpler form by applying transform calculus. But yes, very important concept. In fact, you would have already realized in your chapters like simple harmonic motion, maybe in chapters like solving RLC circuit. or transient states in case of, you know, AC currents. So all those concepts will involve the understanding of differential equations. Okay. So our main agenda today is starting with indefinite integral. Mostly I take around 3 to 4 classes to finish off indefinite. We'll see how fast you are because you have already done this in school. So initially I'll be going slightly faster because you have done things in school. Indefinite integration. Okay, indefinite integration. Indefinite integration basically is a process, right? So this is a process. And from this process, we get something which we call as the primitive of a function. Primitive of a function. Primitive of a function. So this is the outcome from the process. Okay, this is the outcome from the process. Now, what is primitive of a function? See, whenever you have a function, okay, and you differentiate the function. Okay, so let's say you apply the derivative on that function with respect to x, let's say, you end up getting something called the derivative of the function. So this is called the derivative of the function. Okay, derivative of f of x. And this f of x is actually called the primitive of f dash x. Okay, primitive, the word itself literally means something which existed before, primitive man. Okay, the men who existed, you know, much before. Maybe I am talking about Ice Age and all those things. Okay, so the process of obtaining the primitive from the derivative, okay, is through the process of integration. So we apply the process of integration on the derivative to end up getting the primitive. Okay, just to give you a simple real life example, you can say coffee beans. Okay, coffee beans are basically primitive of coffee. The coffee that you have early in the morning, okay, that is actually a derivative of. So derivative of this is your cup of coffee. Okay, it is derived out of it. It is derived out of it, isn't it? Let some steams come out, okay? And then if you want to obtain the coffee beans back from the coffee, you will have to do the integration. Okay, not literally, by the way. This is just a funny example to just talk about it. Okay, so this is the primitive, or let me write it in a correct English format also, primitive. This is the primitive. Okay, primitive, antiderivative, they are all the same thing. Okay. So first of all, I would like to discuss with you why it is called indefinite. Okay, indefinite, let me give you an example for the same. Let us consider a simple scenario. Let's say I talk about 3x squared. This is derivative of some function. Let me name it as f of x. Okay. Now, please understand, this itself is called a first degree differential, first order, first degree differential equation. So this is actually I don't know how many of you have done differential equations in school. This is actually an example of a first order differential equation. Differential equation. Why it is called first order? Because if you see the highest differential coefficient order that is occurring over here is 1. That means you differentiated f of x only once with respect to x. That is the highest time you have differentiated it. That is why it is called first order. Don't worry about order too much. We'll be talking about order in our differential equation chapter in much more detail. So when you solve this differential equation, you have to use the process of integration in calculus. Okay. So from this process of integration, you will end up getting the solution to this differential equation, which is nothing but the primitive, which is nothing but the function. Okay, so which is nothing but the primitive of this guy. So how do you solve it? When you solve it, what answer will you get? Anybody who can tell me the answer that you might get when you solve 3x squared? Whose derivative is 3x squared? Can you guess that? Right, many answers will come from there. Some of you will say x cubed, some of you will say x cubed plus 1, some of you can say x cubed minus 1, da-da-da-da-da. There could be so many answers. That means there is not a single function whose derivative is 3x squared. There are many such functions. In fact, you will say there's a family of curves, or you can say there is an indefinite. There's nothing definite here. So there are an indefinite number of curves whose derivative is going to be 3x squared. So this gives you a family of, you can say, curves here. And because of that, the answer that you will get from here is x cubed plus a c, where c is called the constant of integration, also called the arbitrary constant. Okay. These all things are known to you already. I'm just, you know, just revising it so that everybody is on the same page. So this c is called the constant of integration. Am I breaking up? I mean, is my voice breaking up or is it fine? Was breaking up. Okay. Okay, let me switch off my camera for the time being. Maybe a little later on I will switch it on. Okay, so you get so many answers. So there is no definite. There is no definite answer. There is no definite curve. Okay. And hence the concept of indefinite. So this is why we call it as indefinite integrals. Okay. That means there could be so many curves like x cubed plus one, x cubed plus two. Okay, x cubed minus one, such that if you take any x point on it, let's say if I take any x point, okay, and I sketch the gradient or sketch a tangent, the gradient of the tangent will all be the same. Okay, that means all these curves have the same slope function at that point. Okay, so because there is no definite curve, there's a family of curves. That's why we call this particular topic as indefinite integrals. Now, the first part of this chapter will be slightly, you can say, repetitive part, where I will be talking about integrals of certain standard function from the virtue of the fact that we know its derivatives. Okay. So the next part of the topic will be finding the antiderivative or finding the antiderivative of derivative, or you can say primitive of standard functions, not all the standard functions, by the way, okay, by the virtue that we know the derivative of those functions. Okay, so by the process that differentiation and integration are inverse processes, we'll be trying to find out from our knowledge of derivatives, antiderivatives of certain functions. Okay, so let me begin with a simple, I think I've already given this in your bridge course also. So derivative of a constant is zero. So integral of a constant with respect to x is a constant. Okay, derivative of x with respect to x is one. So integral of one with respect to x is going to be x plus a c. Please note that while differentiation is a, you can say, one-to-one correspondence, here it is one-to-many correspondence. Okay, so you have to write a c here. Now, many times I've seen students, not using the proper notations over here. See, let me explain you first of all what this notation actually means. Maybe you would have been, explained this in school. This symbol is basically a stretched s. Okay, s for summation. The symbol was devised by the German mathematician Gottfried Wilhelm Leibniz. Okay. And this expression itself is basically summing up something which we call as a differential area. This is the area actually. So if you write an expression like this, okay, this is nothing but a differential area, and you're trying to sum up a differential area to get an area function out of it. Okay. So when you write an area function, you need, let's say this is my function f of x. Okay, this is my graph of f of x. So at a distance x, okay, if you take a differential change in the x, let's say this is your dx. So this is the height and this is the width of this differential area. So this dA is formed by the height into width, which is f of x into d of x. Okay, so f of x dx, that is your differential area. When you sum up this differential area, basically you are integrating it. And this process gives you the primitive, which is also called the area function. Okay, so the answer that we get is an area function. So if you don't write this dx, please note that you're trying to find the area of a rectangle without multiplying it with the width or maybe the length. Okay. So people who write such kind of an expression in the school exams and all, I definitely give them zero, at least for my NAFL students, because this is not an area function. Right. So please do not do such kind of mistakes when you have a subjective paper happening in, let's say, in your board exam or in your school. Of course, in JEE and all, nobody's going to bother too much about it. By the way, I hope you have all got to know about our JEE results. I think the best rank in the JEE main was around 900 by Tripan. He is from NPS Rajaji Nagar. 900 rank in JEE main exam is a very, very, you can say, a good achievement, actually, because it was written by almost 10.5 lakh students. Okay. So out of 10.5 lakhs, being under 1,000 is a very big achievement. Okay. So most of them, I think every fifth student is a 99 percentile. And you already know some of them who have already scored 100 percentile in physics and mathematics. By the way, next turn is yours. So you people will be now facing the music in a couple of months' time, and I'm sure you are well prepared. Please do not give up at this point of time, because here you need to pull up your socks and work even harder. Okay. Don't get burned out. Too many exams are going to come. School exams, your pre-boards maybe will happen very soon. And then you'll have the first term. First term will continue for 1 month. And then you will have a crash course happening from our side. And then maybe, who knows, the JEE notification comes out for January. So a lot of exams will be up. So some of you called me in the last week's session and said you're already tired, right? You're planning to, you know, slow down a bit. This is not a time to slow down, let me tell you, right? It's like slowing down in the last lap of your race, right? So please ensure that you are at your performing best for the couple of, I would say, hardly 6 to 7 months more. Okay. And then you will see the, you know, outcome of it. I think the notification has not come out. Only the result has come out for the previous JEE just 2 days ago. So Hariharan, we are not very sure when the application will be starting, but maybe 1 month at least you have to wait. Okay. And the problem with your batch would be now that there are two board exams. So what will happen? One month each will go in that. See, even if you don't want to give that 1 month time, subconsciously, it will be running in your mind that my boards are going on, right? Even if you want to, you cannot prepare for competitive exams. So that problem was not there with the last batch. They had the exam towards the end of their completion of syllabus, and you know, whatever time it says, it did not matter. Here, your board exams may continue till December mid. So full 1 month will go in that. And again, one month more will go in the second semester exam. So 1 month here is like, you know, it is trapped. Okay. So you need to be further more judicious in time management. Are you getting my point? Because in this 1 month, probably you will not try to experiment too much. My suggestion would be, if you get your schedule, which I think I'm told that you haven't got it yet from the boards, right? You just know it is going to happen in November. You haven't got the schedule, right? Mid-November, right? So ISC is happening in mid-November. So I think CBSE will also be happening around the same time. So for ISC, it is going till December 22nd. So maybe yours also will go to December 22nd, maybe. And then I think New Year will happen and everything will, you know, take place during that time. So please ensure that you don't over-prepare. At the same time, you don't under-prepare also. Are you getting what I'm trying to say? Like for a 50% syllabus, don't give 3 months of your time. I mean, you can cover up, and this is an objective-based exam. You're anyways very good at it. So don't over-prepare. That is what is my concern. Okay. Because later on, nowadays what is happening, that people are not paying attention to the semester two topics. As you can see, the attendance in today's class is only 27. Whereas it used to be around 38 or something. That means these 11 students think that semester two topic is going on. Why to pay attention? And when they will come in semester two, this would have already been covered. And that time they would be doing a self-study of this topic and, you know, doing a very shoddy understanding of the concept. So don't overdo it. That is what is my request to you. If I were you, I will first address the topics which has very less time or less time gap. Maybe in some exam, you only get 1 day or 2 day gap. I will do those topics, or I'll start doing those topics. For those subjects which I have enough time, let's say one week time or 1 week gap is there, I will probably do the revision in the 1 week time only. Okay. And yes, it is going to overlap with KVPY as well. That's all the more reason why I'm requesting you, don't overdo things. Okay. Don't be like, okay, my life is now semester one topics. I will not look at anything else. No, that in that case, you will not do well in KVPY. And you'll have to, you'll struggle in semester two topics concepts. Anyways, I'll keep giving you all those gyans little later on. So we already know derivative of x square by 2 is x. So integral of x dx will be x square by 2 plus c. And now this is good enough for us to figure out that if you want to differentiate x to the power n plus 1 by n plus 1, the derivative is x to the power n. So integral of x to the power n with respect to x is x to the power n plus 1 by n plus 1. N cannot be minus 1 here. And this rule is what we call as the power rule of integration. You are already aware of it. So you might be finding me slightly fast over here. Okay, because you have been using it since your physics first chapter. Okay, maths, you are officially learning it right now. So please note this down. Derivative of ln mod x with respect to x is x. Okay. So integral of 1 by x with respect to x is going to be ln mod x plus c. Now, this is something which is important. Many people ask, sir, we were told that only derivative of ln x is 1 by x. How come ln mod x derivative is 1 by x? See, it doesn't matter. Ln mod x, if you redefine it, it is ln x when x is positive and ln of negative x when x is negative, right? Now, it doesn't matter whichever form you differentiate. Let's say if you differentiate the first one, this result is already x. 1 by x, you know. Even if you differentiate this, you're still going to get 1 by x. Isn't it? So still gives you 1 by x. So it doesn't matter. So whether ln x or ln mod x, the derivative is 1 by x only. Okay. So integral of x to the power minus 1 with respect to x is ln mod x plus c. So this basically fills the gap where your n is minus 1. So this is a place where your n is actually minus 1. Okay. Let's also discuss the derivative of exponential functions. A to the power x by ln a derivative with respect to x is a to the power x. So integral of a to the power x with respect to x is going to be a to the power x by ln a plus c. And a special case of it, when your a is e, it becomes something like this. These results are already known, so I'm just going a little fast over here. Can I go to the next slide? And one more insider I have got to know from the trainings that I'm attending with respect to All India Math Teacher Association, that your objective questions are going to be framed out of the subjective questions of your past year. Okay, this is what I have come to know. So there has been already a team who is working to convert past year subjective questions into objective questions. Okay. So this is an insider information, but mostly many of you would have already speculated it also. So please ensure that past year papers of CBSE, at least last 10 years paper, you don't leave any paper unsolved. Okay. And now I think the market has already been flooded with MCQ type chapter wise questions and all. You can easily find it in Sapna bookstore. You can get it from there. I think you can also try sites like kitabkopi.com. they have a soft copy of these OSWAL textbooks. But yes, you have to pay some minor amount, 150, 200 rupees, depending upon which book you need. Okay. Kitabkopi.com. You can check it out after the class. Okay. All right. So we'll be talking now about trig functions. Sin x derivative is already known with respect to x, which is cos x. And cos x integration with respect to x will be sin x plus c. Sin x plus c. Derivative of negative cos x with respect to x is sin x. So integral of sin x with respect to x is negative cos x plus c. Okay. Derivative of tan x is known to us as secant square x. So integral of secant square x with respect to x is tan x plus c. These results are already well known to us. I'm just putting it in a form of a note so that you can later on access to it if you want to. Integral of sec x is sec x tan x. Sorry, derivative of sec x is sec x tan x. So integral of sec x tan x is sec x plus c. Derivative of minus cosec x is cosec x cot x. So integral of minus integral of cosec x cot x with respect to x is minus cosec x plus c. Derivative of negative cot x is cosecant square x. So integral of cosecant square x with respect to x is minus cot x plus c. And apart from this, we have also learned our inverse trig functions. This is going to be sine inverse x plus c. Or you can also write it as negative cos inverse x plus c. Doesn't make much of a difference in both the results. By the way, in integration, this is a well seen, you can say, problem, or you can say commonly seen problem, that your answer that you get and the answer at the back of the book might not match. Okay. They may differ in constants, number one, or they may differ in the forms. For example, when we deal with trig functions, or many a times we do substitutions to solve questions. So depending upon what substitution we have made, your answer will be, coming in form of that. Somebody has solved the same question by using some alternative substitution. He will get mostly the same form, but yes, in a more simplified manner, or in a more, different format. So the answer at the back of the book and the answer that you get may differ either in constants or they may differ in their simplification. Maybe some trigonometric identities have been applied to simplify it. So please watch out for those things. In fact, in competitive exams, including your first semester exam or second semester exam, if it happens in objective format, please be driven by the options. Okay. Don't solve any question in objective format without looking at the options. Look at the options first. Okay. Try all your, MCQ solving, strategies. For example, let's say if you have been given A and B values to find out and you realize that A values are same in all the options, why will you waste time finding A? Let's go for B first, because B will be the distinguisher. So like that, you save your time in these competitive exams as well as your semester exams also. Okay. I mean, you are already experienced enough. After 1.5 years, Okay, by the way, this itself, it comes from directly this result, so which I don't have to write it again. So this is either you can say cos inverse x plus c, or you can say negative sine inverse x plus c. Okay. By the way, for tan, I will write without mentioning cot inverse. So this is tan inverse x. I will not write cot inverse. Cot inverse is directly driven by this. Next is sec inverse. Sec inverse is 1 by x under root x square minus 1. So integral of this term is going to be sec inverse x plus a c. Okay. However, don't be surprised if you see minus cot inverse x plus c here and minus cosec inverse x plus c here. Both are same thing because tan inverse plus cot inverse is pi by 2. So you can always write tan inverse as pi by 2 minus cot inverse. Pi by 2 plus c will become another constant of integration. Now, something very optional over here, if you are stuck with a problem where it involves hyperbolic functions. So these are optional results. I mean, just for your extra knowledge. So hyperbolic functions, many of you would be not aware of. I'll just talk about it in brief. So hyperbolic functions, sine hyperbolic x. By the way, this is pronounced as shine. I mean, the English word shine, the sun shines. Okay, shine x. So when you say shine x, it is to be treated as sine hyperbolic x. And sine hyperbolic x expression in terms of exponential function is this. Okay. This is cosh. Cosh. Oh, I'm so sorry. This is minus. This is plus. Yeah. Then dan. Tan hyperbolic x. Dan is nothing but shine by cosh, which is e to the power x minus e to the power minus x by e to the power x plus e to the power minus x. Please note that shine is an odd function. Okay, so this is an odd function. Cosh, just like cos, is a even function. Okay, even function. Okay. It is just a name given to it. See, the name hyperbolic functions were given to this because it was observed that cos hyperbolic x minus sine hyperbolic x was actually a 1. Okay. You can try it out by using these two expressions. And this very much resembles something like x square minus y square is equal to 1, which happens to be a rectangular hyperbola. Correct. And because of this, it was given the name of a hyperbolic functions. So this term that you see, this term that you see, this term that you see, they're actually given a special name. Okay. Sine hyperbolic x, cos hyperbolic x, tan hyperbolic x. Just for your information, Anusha, many times such expressions are not used, but in case they are used, you should not be like surprised. Okay. A few things that I would like to share over here is that sine hyperbolic x derivative is cos hyperbolic x. That you can easily see over here. If you differentiate this, you get the cos hyperbolic x function. Similarly, the derivative of cos hyperbolic x or cosh is shine. Okay. Anyways, and a few things that we will be now requiring over here is these functions have inverses. So inverse of hyperbolic functions. You already know how to find inverses because you have already done it in the functions chapter. So please note down the inverses also. Sine hyperbolic inverse x is given by, in the language of ln, it is ln of x plus under root of x square plus 1. Okay, this is sine hyperbolic x. Now those who have done integration in school, what do they represent? They have a graph. For example, I'll just show you the graph in some time. Cos hyperbolic inverse x is expressed as this. Have you seen this expression in integration concept in school? Do you realize that this came in some special standard integrals? Right. Okay. So please note this down. These will be, you know, important. Tan hyperbolic inverse x is half ln 1 plus x by 1 minus x. Okay. So later on when we do our standard integrals, we'll come to know that integral of under root of 1 plus x square or x square plus 1 is given by sine hyperbolic inverse x plus c, or what you know as ln of x plus under root x square plus 1 plus c. Okay. Similarly, integration of under root of x square minus 1 is cos hyperbolic inverse x plus c, which is ln of x plus under root x square minus 1. In school, we don't tell that this is actually hyperbolic inverse or sine hyperbolic inverse or cos hyperbolic inverse. We only use the ln part of it, but this is just for your info that if you come across such an expression, you should not be surprised. Similarly, this term is 1 by 2 ln, or you can say 1. Let me write it in terms of hyperbolic first. So it is written as tan hyperbolic inverse x plus c. What you know in school is half ln mod 1 plus x by 1 minus x. Okay? But both are the same things. Both are the same things. Yes, so I'll show you quickly the hyperbolic functions. How do they look like? Just they are normal curves only, not something outside, out of the box. Okay, so when you write SIN, it will prompt you for this. Okay. So this curve is same as y is equal to e to the power x minus e to the power minus x whole divided by 2. Okay, as you can see, both the curves are overlapping each other. So I'll just switch one on. Okay. And both are the same thing. Okay, so this is a sine hyperbolic function. And it's a mirror image about y equal to x line is your sine hyperbolic inverse. Let me write first and then I'll explain you. Plus 1 to the power of 0.5. Yeah. So this is your inverse of this function. As you can see, they are mirror image about y equal to x line. Okay. So this is what I was discussing with you. And I would also like you to see the graph of cos hyperbolic inverse and cos hyperbolic x, both of them. So this is your cosh. It's like a parabola only. I had shown you in the bridge course maybe. So this is actually called a catenary. This curve is actually called a catenary. Catenary. Okay, and it's inverse also. Let's see the graph. So y is equal to ln x plus x square minus 1 to the power of half. Right now in the present shape, it will not be. It will only be partly for your x, which is positive. So let's draw it first. Okay, so it is only the mirror image of this part. Okay, when your x is positive, because right now it's not a 1-1 function. So it is not going to be invertible in the present shape. But if you just draw half the part of it, just this part only. Okay, so this part inverse when x is greater than 0. Okay, I think you can, x is greater than 0, you'll be able to find out the inverse of it. Okay, anyways. So this is the concept related to hyperbolic functions. So if you see your response in the competitive exam in terms of hyperbolic inverse, don't be surprised. So many a times they will write this as sine hyperbolic inverse, cos hyperbolic inverse. I would not use the word many a times, but it may be a random case. It may be a random scenario. Okay. So I'll wait on this slide. No worries. This should be greater than 1 actually. greater than equal to 1. Done, Anusha. Okay. Let's now look into the rules of integration, or you can say algebra of integration. Now, I will not disclose all the rules here because we have certain rules which we'll learn a little later on, like integration by parts, etc. So the basic rules I will definitely discuss with you. The first rule is, if you have a function multiplied to a constant, then you just take the constant out and multiply it with the primitive and just put a c at the end. Okay. Of course, these results are also been already used by you, so this is not a new thing for us. We have already been seeing this. So if you want to find the integral of, by the way, the function whose integral we are finding, it is called as the integrand. For example, this is your integrand. Okay. And here, please note that the C that you will be putting will be only towards the end of the process. Okay. Don't put a C every time that you integrate. Just combine all the C's and put it towards the end. Sir, why should we put a C out? I didn't get it. Taking the cons out means? Whatever you're doing, even if you don't write it, it's fine. The constant of integration will automatically come out from it. Okay. Next is, by the way, this rule I will write it in red for the simple reason because such a rule doesn't exist. And many of you who have learned this chapter in the bridge course, while I was seeing the assignment, I saw that most of you had done a very, very, you can say, outrageous extrapolation of this particular formula, applying your product rule of differentiation into your product rule of integration. So please note, such a rule, if you are thinking, okay, as of now, nobody is thinking of this, I'm sure, but such a rule doesn't exist. Please do not apply such rule ever. Okay. Similarly, one more rule, which I would again write it in red because this rule doesn't exist. So if you have something like this, please do not do this. I'm just writing it in a very, you can say, mockery sense, but many people in the bridge course, you were too young actually, so you're too early for you to learn this concept. These things are absolutely rubbish. Okay. They don't work. Okay. There is no quotient rule. There is no product rule like the way you have in your differentiation. So no extrapolation of any rules, please. No extrapolation of any rules. In fact, later on also, this will be applicable. Okay. I was taking a session on integration in my school, and some of the students, they thought that integration is just the opposite of what, or just the same way as what they use in differentiation. And they say, integration is very easy. And I started giving them few questions, basic ones. And I was shocked to see that they were, flouting these rules left, right, and center. Okay. So don't do these mistakes. Don't do these extrapolations just to, apply differentiation concept. See, both are not only inverses in the process, but also inverses in the approaches also. One is very conventional while other is not conventional. I don't want to scare you. However, you have something called integration by parts. So that is something which you will see later on. Integration by parts. So integration by parts helps us to find out the integral of product of two functions. But this is to be used only when it is required, because if you see the rule, this rule comes with a cost of you writing it in form of another integral. Okay. So one integral gets converted to another integral. So please note that this process is not to be misused, because you may end up getting an integral which is even more complicated, or you may not be able to finish up this process. It may enter into a, you can say, infinite loop kind of a scenario. Okay, so this we'll see later on, not to worry about it. I think maybe the next class we'll be talking about it, not as early as today. And one of the most important rule that we are going to discuss here is the reverse chain rule. So reverse chain rule is basically a very, you can say, mild version of substitution. Okay, so why I call it as a mild version of substitution? If let's say a integral is known to you, let's say if f of x integral is known to you as g of x plus c, and you want to evaluate integral of a linear extension of x. So let's say x is linearly extended to ax plus b. A and b could be any real numbers. Okay. Then you can also write this as g of ax plus b by a plus c. This comes directly from your substitution concept, which you'll be taking up in some time. So how it works basically is like you take your ax plus b as a t. So a dx will become a dt. So dx becomes 1 by a dt. So when you substitute it in this expression, it becomes f of t 1 by a dt. And this integral, or the primitive here, is g of t. So you can write it like this and just add a constant of integration. Of course, don't leave your answer in terms of new variable. This becomes your answer. Okay. So please do not misuse this rule. For example, if you know cos x integration is sin x, and somebody asks you what is the integration of cos 2x plus 3. Okay, so let's say cos x integration is known, which is sin x. And somebody says, what is the integration of cos 2x plus 3? Then you can write this answer as sin 2x plus 3 by 2. Okay, whole divided by 2 plus c. But let's say somebody asks you, what is the integration of cos of x square? Then no, then this method is not going to work. Okay, don't start dividing it. Don't do sin x square divided by x and all. Okay, so this is not going to work in such cases. As I told you, no extrapolation of formula. By the way, there are certain integrals which are not integrable in the sense that they cannot be integrated by the methods that you will be learning. For them, you need to use some numerical techniques, which is called the numerical solution of integrals. That's beyond our scope right now. In fact, some of the international boards do teach them in their class 11th and 12th. For example, I have been taking classes for AL curriculum, A levels. So there they teach them some of the numerical methods to evaluate integrals. But many a times you will not be exactly able to evaluate an integral, because it may be not be, you know, driven by certain procedures. So for them, you need a numerical solution of integrals, which you will learn later on, maybe in undergrad. So in AICTE syllabus, it is basically taught in your undergrad curriculum. In undergrad curriculum, for 4 semesters, you will be doing maths out of 8 semesters of your BTech. If at all you're trying to do BTech from any engineering college, for 4 semesters, you will have maths. So in each of the semesters, you will be given some different mathematical tools. So those numerical techniques are definitely a part of your, I think I learned it in my 3rd semester. I don't exactly remember 3rd or 2nd semester. So those things we will not be covering in our class 12th or JEE preparation. All right, now time to test you on whatever you have done so far. I know most of you have already done basic integration in school. So we'll do some general problems just as a warm up. Okay, just to check where do you actually stand in your understanding of these rules and your formulas. So let me begin with this simple question. Integrate secant square x into cosecant square x with respect to x. On your chat box, just say a done. Done. Very good, Sitij. Pratik, done. Gayatri, done. Okay. Can we discuss it out? Okay, Pradeep, let's discuss it out. Anusha, done. Okay. All right. So let me ask Anusha, how did you do this question? If you can unmute and talk, that would be great.
So you had given us a rule in the
Happy to.
previous few slides. So I
Yeah.
used the
Which rule?
The integral of f of x g of x dx is equal to f of x integral of g of x dx minus integral of d by dx of f of x, that rule.
Oh, you use that rule? Integration
Yeah.
works.
Yes, sir.
Okay. I mean, wasn't it complicated using that?
I realized after I almost
Okay.
finished it.
So please do not use integration of parts very so early because definitely you will be using it later on, but only for problems which require integration by parts to be used. See, first of all, I wrote this guy as 1 by cos square sine square, and I wrote that 1 as sine square plus cos square. Individually, you divide each one of them by the denominator. So if you divide, this will become sec square. And if you divide this by this, it will become a cosec square. Okay. And these two are basically your functions whose standard integrals are already known. So this is tan x and this is minus of cot x. So your answer is tan x minus cot x plus c. Is this fine? How many of you got this answer? Pradyun, I don't think so that will give that answer, Pradyun. Okay. All right, let's take another one. Let's do x square plus cos square x multiplied with cosecant square x whole divided by 1 plus x square. My problems may seem to be slightly challenging because why I'm purposely giving you challenging because you have already done it in school. Okay. Is there any person who is attending this session who has not done integration in school? I don't think so. There's anybody like that. Mostly all of you have done it in school. Okay, so I'm giving you only them handpicked problems, which are slightly may look complicated to This topic is practice driven, so even if you are preparing very hard for your semester one topics, please save some time for doing integration in between. But that's not what you gave me, right, Pradyum? You gave two cot x to me. How is your answer same as this? Okay. Again, just write it done if you're done, okay? See, the solution of this doesn't require any prior knowledge. Just whatever we have discussed in the previous 7 to 8 slides, that is more than enough to solve this question. Don't start applying higher versions of your knowledge of integration. Maybe we'll be saving that for our upcoming concepts. Okay. Yes. Any success, anybody? Having no quotient rule, etc. is basically a challenge, actually. So you have lesser tools. The complexity of the problem is almost the same as what we used to get in our differentiation. But we have a lesser tool to basically get our results. So integration becomes more challenging. Okay, so let's solve this question. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a one here and subtract a one. Okay. Just because I want to create a 1 plus x square term. How will that help us? And how will that cosecant square be taken care of? Let us try to have a look at it. So first of all, I'll write it as x square plus 1 minus 1 minus cos square. Okay. Whole thing multiplied with cosecant square. And 1 plus x square in the denominator, I will just simply write it below these terms. Okay. This is anyways a 1. This is sine square by 1 plus x square. And there's a cosecant square waiting outside. Multiply with this cosecant square throughout. Okay. Now, if you see, this form is pretty much integrable because cosecant square x integration is minus cot x and 1 by 1 plus x square is tan inverse x. So integration of 1 by 1 plus x square is a tan inverse x. We have already seen these formulas in our standard results. Is it fine? Aditya, now it is clear? Yes. So you have to think, unconventionally while solving these questions. Any question, any concerns here? I think only Shitish could solve it. Can I go to the next slide? Okay. Next slide, I'll give you a question, which is actually very commonly asked question in board exam also. And there's a twin of this also. There's a twin question of this, and that is tan x by sec x plus tan x. Okay, so please try this out. It's a very simple question. Again, let me know by saying a done on the chat box. Done. If you just have a good command on your trigonometry, you can solve this question within 20 seconds. Siddharth is also done. Done. Gaurav is done. Gayatri is done. Great. So you just have to recall that 1 by secx plus tan x is actually secx minus tan x. That's it. I'm sure you would have done this property a million times in class 10th itself, right? So this question is as good as secx times secx minus tan x, which is actually nothing but integration of secant square x minus secx tan x. And this result is only a tan x. This result is only a secx plus c. Okay. Same goes with here as well, the twin problem. Okay, so here one extra step you might have to do. You get a minus tan square, right? Minus tan square, you just write it as secant square minus 1. Or you just do one thing, add a secx, subtract a secx, you'll get a 1 minus this integral. Okay. Anyways, we'll do it here also. It doesn't take much of a time. So this will give you sec x minus tan x. Integration of this is going to give you a plus x. Sine cos conversion also will give you the same result, but yes, maybe with slightly more time involved, isn't it? Time factor will be slightly more. Next. Try this out. Any idea, anybody? Okay, yes. So basically you have to write this expression as a square, try to convert it to a perfect square, not a perfect square, try to make a square out of it. So this expression is x square minus 7x plus 12, right? Can I write it as this x minus 7 by 2, the whole square? I'll give you minus 49 by 4 and you want this. So minus 1 by 4. In short, it gives you 2x minus 7 square by minus 1 by 4, right? Okay. So this term over here that you have within the under root sign, this term, can we not write it as 2x minus 7 the whole square minus 1 by 4? That 4 will go on the top and become a 2. Okay. Now let us try to recall one of the formulas that we have done in the beginning part of today's chapter, which was integral of x under root x square minus 1. What was it? Secant inverse x plus c, right? Now you can see there's a linear extension of x as 2x minus 7. So the same result will now become twice of secant inverse 2x minus 7 by 2. Of course, this 2 and 2 will get cancelled off, giving you the result like this. Okay. Many times people ignore this formula. Okay. They don't remember secant inverse x, the integral of 1 by x under root x square minus 1 is secant inverse x. Is it fine? See, there are many ways to do it also. You can substitute 2x plus 1 as 1 by t, Siddhant. But that process we'll discuss little later on, in fact, much later on in our chapter when I do irrational function integration with you. Yes, you can do this by that method also. That is a more robust way. This was like by chance, this came out to be like this. And okay, then you realize, oh, I could apply sec inverse x answer over here. So the other method, which I'll be going to talk about later on, will be helping you to integrate something like linear under root quadratic. So this form I will take up a little later on in the integration chapter, and I will tell you how to integrate the very same by this process. Okay. Here, actually, you're not aware here, the substitution is the linear term should be substituted as 1 by t. But anyways, we'll talk about it later on. Officially, I have not even started talking about substitution. To be very precise, none of the question that we did required substitution. Okay. I'm just checking your basic integration skills. That is why I wrote general problems on integration. I've not even started any kind of substitution so far. Okay, next one. Maybe I should switch on a poll for this. If you're done, you can give a response on the poll. Okay, Gaurav. That was quick. I think 1.5 minutes only. And two people have already responded. That was quick. Good. CT is all about speed. Concepts are pretty simple. It's all about speed. Three people, three answers. Oh my God. What is this? Okay. Finally, one option is leading. This is a CT based question. Okay, last 30 seconds, because almost 2.5 minutes have gone. Sor, I joined in now. What happened, Sor? Your internet was out. With whom? Sor, this excuse is very old, Sor. Give some new excuse, Sor. Normally when internets go out, there's some cable damage or something that normally takes at least half a day to get repaired. Sir, very frankly speaking, sir, I had a lot of rice in the afternoon and I went to bed and I went into deep sleep and now I woke up. Just kidding, Charan. I trust you. Don't worry. Okay, guys, chalo. We'll call it off now. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Take a guess. Take a guess. Okay. People are refusing from guessing. Sir, JE main exam, sir, negative marks. Okay. So most of you have said B. B for Bangalore. I know why people... B is supposed to be the safest option when you don't know it. Okay. Now, the very first thing that will come in my mind, in fact, it should come to the mind of any student, is cos A plus cos B formula, which is 2 cos A plus B by 2 into cos A minus B by 2. Okay. Now, what to do? Now, can I use half angles here also? So instead of cos 3x, I can write 2 cos square 3x by 2 minus 1. When you simplify this, you would realize in the denominator, at least I can see a 3 minus 4 cos square 3x by 2 coming. Now, this basically rings a bell in my mind. What bell it rings is that had I provided it with a cos x by 2, this fellow would have easily become the formula for cos 9x by 2, which is sitting on the top. So let's do that. Let's provide it with a cos x by 2. Okay. So when you provide it with a cos x by 2 in the denominator, let's see what miracle happens because of that. Okay. So there is a 3x by 2. Oh, my bad. Sorry. This is 3x by 2. Cos x by 2, cos 3x by 2. Okay. Now down in the denominator, this becomes 3 cos 3x by 2 minus 4 cos cube 3x by 2. This is actually a formula for cos 9x by 2. Isn't it? So cos 9x by 2 gets cancelled from here and here. Okay. Leaving you finally with 2 cos x by 2 cos 3x by 2. Now basically use your transformation formula to convert product into sum. This is as good as saying there was a negative sign also, I believe, here. Yeah, there will be a negative sign also coming because this is a formula for negative cos 3x. Yeah, negative sign. Yeah. So this is going to give you nothing but negative, just combine it back, cos 2x plus cos x, isn't it? Isn't it? Any questions, any concerns? Yeah. So this is nothing but negative sine 2x by 2, negative sine x. In fact, you can take negative common plus a c. Is this an option for us? Yes, option D. Okay. Now, this was just a play with your trigonometric identities. If you know your trigonometric identities well, then this is basically a simple error. Is it fine? Okay. Next, we'll start taking up a question which will basically, you know, require us to start thinking in some different angle as well. Let's take this question. I put the poll on also in case you want to give a response. Okay, I've got a response. Okay, those who want to respond, please do so within the next 30 seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Okay, not many of you have responded, but again, I think just the guesswork has gone in. Most of you have again said B as your preferred option. Anyways, we'll check whether B is correct or not. See, here you realize that the new denominator term, let me write down the denominator term in an expanded format. Okay. Just try to differentiate this term. If you differentiate this term, you'll get 3x square plus e to the power x plus x e to the power x. Okay. Now, to a certain extent, in the numerator that you have x e to the power x minus 2 e to the power x, let us try to generate that term using this derivative. Okay. Now, through this, I want to make something very interesting, very important outcome from this particular approach. So if you write this term, you'll see that this term is already there. So I'll just write down this term exactly as it is. And then I'll do some omission and addition if at all it is required. So I don't need a 3x square because there is no 3x square in the right side. I need a minus 2x cubed. So I'll do minus 3 e to the power x. So as you can see, this term is already there. Minus 2 e to the power x. This will give you minus 2 e to the power x. And there's no e to the power, there's no 3x square term. So I subtracted it. So basically, I've written the numerator in a very, you can say, interesting manner over here. Now, why did I choose to write it like this? Let us now divide this term by the denominator itself, both sides. Okay. And your problem statement is integrating this, right? That means you have to integrate this. Okay. So how does this breakup help us to integrate it? Let us look at the terms written in white first, divided separately by the denominator. Okay, x cube, x e to the power x, any way you can write it, doesn't matter. Here, if you take a minus 3 common, you have x square e to the power x divided by x square e to the power x. Okay, so you are basically willing to integrate this. Okay, so first thing that you'll observe that this and this will get cancelled off. And you can write it separately as two integrals. Okay. So what you see here in the first integral is that your numerator contains the derivative of the denominator, isn't it? Because this term was actually the derivative of the denominator, right? So this whole term that you see is your differential of this term, isn't it? Okay. Now, this term is already well known to us. It is 3 ln mod x plus c. Now, please understand here that whenever you get such kind of an integral, it is basically hinting towards the fact that if I start calling this as another variable, let's say a t. Okay, let's say I start calling this as a t. Then your numerator is going to be a dt. Okay, so here is you can say the evolution of substitution method, right? And substitution method is one of the, you can say, I call it as a heart and soul of integration, because in almost 70-80% of the question you would require substitution, maybe once, maybe twice, maybe multiple times also to solve the question. So substitution is basically a method in integration which converts a complicated integrand into an expression which is easy to integrate. So it just converts one integrand to a simpler integrand whose result is easy to be found out or easily available to us or easily figured out. Okay. So this expression itself would have been a difficult one until unless you realize that, oh, if I call my denominator as a t, numerator will become a dt. And now 1 by t dt integration, anybody can do it because this is one of the standard results you have already seen. So your answer becomes ln mod, whatever is the denominator term, okay, minus, you may write it in a fancy way like this, okay, and club up your ln terms together. So it is going to be 1 plus e to the power x by x square plus a c. In fact, all the terms are positive, so you can just remove the mod and put normal brackets over it. So is this in the options? Yes, option number A. Got it. So here is now the approach of substitution that is being introduced. So now we'll talk about method of substitution from here on. And the very first thing that I would like to, you know, discuss over here is how to find integration of certain functions which we had not seen in our formula list. If I go back to the formula list, you would realize that in the formula list, I had not given you the integration of many trigonometric functions. If you see this list, there is no integration. If you see the right side, there is no integration of tan. There's no integration of cot. There's no integration of sec. There's no integration of cosec. So all these results which I have skipped out can now easily be found out by method of substitution, which I'm going to take up now. And we are going to spend a considerable amount of time on this till you are all confident about this approach, method of substitution. So this is this method is not a, you can say, a conventional step-by-step mechanism. Okay, do this, and you get your answer. It is just a, you can say, a ballpark approach which helps you to solve a problem. It doesn't give you a precise, you know, this thing that, okay, whenever this comes, you have to do this substitution. I mean, of course, we have made some rules because of so much of practice, but this is mostly driven by your art of substitution. So it's an art, I would say, just like coding is an art. Okay. So in this part, you'll have to be observant. Okay, if I do substitute this, probably it'll convert the problem to a simpler integrand. Okay. Why did you choose to use substitution here? Because without that, how will you solve it? Partial fractions. You know what is partial fractions, Shitesh? Partial fraction is an approach to convert a proper rational functions into simpler rational functions. We don't apply partial fractions to trigonometric functions and exponential functions directly. We have to convert it by some substitution to a polynomial based function. Do you call this as partial fraction? This is not called partial fraction. Maybe your intention is to call it as breaking up into fractions, but this is not called partial fractions. Okay. And see, the thing here is that if you don't use substitution, how else will you solve it? That is my question. There is no you can say quotient rule. There's nothing like you will break it out from it to get a simpler function. Even if you do, what will you do with that? Are you getting my point? So the thing is, you have to learn to think out of the box sometimes, and mostly that will come from exposing yourself to more and more questions. So I'll start my discussion with, I should start my discussion with tan x. So when it comes to method of substitution, the very first problem that we'll be targeting to solve is integration of tan x. Okay. So in tan x, we have sin x by cos x. Now this is a plain simple expression. What do you do with this? Or are you aware of any function whose derivative is tan x? Then that is good enough. That will help us to solve our problem. But unfortunately, I am not aware of any function directly, or even if I have done in the past, I don't remember having seen a function whose derivative is going to be tan x. So how else are you going to solve this question? What if it is inconsistent equation? What if it doesn't give you any a and b? If it does, then well and good. Replacing x with tan inverse x, then what will happen? Then you have to change your dx as 1 by 1 plus x squared. Now, I'm not saying that is wrong, but idea is you have to substitute at any stage, whether you do. See, what you're saying is absolutely, you can apply it. You're saying, let's substitute x as tan inverse of, let's say, t. Okay. So dx will become 1 by 1 plus t squared dt. Okay. When you put it over here, it becomes tan of tan inverse t. Okay. Into 1 by 1 plus t squared dt, correct? Which is actually, if you consider this to be this expression, here you have to use a substitution again. And the substitution is you have to put 1 plus t squared as, let's say, another variable, let's say u, right? And differentiate both sides with respect to t again. You'll end up getting t dt as du by 2 or half du. So it becomes half du by u. And that's nothing but half ln mod u plus c. So substitution was required, whether you go for this kind of a substitution or any other substitution. So it's half ln 1 plus t square. Okay. And t was, I think, tan x. Okay. That is nothing but half ln sec square. And that is ln mod sec x plus c. Absolutely. This is a right answer. Correct. But the point is substitution. Substitution was required to solve it. Okay. Directly, why to do so much things when you can do it? Let's say I call this as approach number one. You could do approach number two where you directly substitute cos x as your t. Okay. Why to do so much of things? So when you do that, you get negative sin x dx as your dt. So your numerator, by the way, I'll just rewrite this step once again. When we teach a person a novice person integration, we do it step by. We say we differentiate both sides with respect to x, and we write it like this. And then we shift the dx to the other side. I hope nobody has a problem and I jump from this step to this step, because I don't have time to write all these stuff, because we are up against time crunch in the examination hall. Okay. So your numerator is directly negative dt. Okay. Denominator was a t. So it gives you directly ln mod t plus c, which is directly minus ln mod cos x plus c, which is directly ln sec x plus c. Okay. Now I can still solve this problem if I take sin x as a t. But problem is we have to find out a way which will give us a faster result. So that's what I was saying. Multiple substitutions can lead up to the answer, but the challenge is which substitution will save my time, right? So I could also take sin x as t and get my problem done. So I'll give you a third approach, third way to solve it. Okay. So what I will do, I will take sin x as a t. Okay. So cos x dx will become a dt. So I will manually generate a cos x here by multiplying and dividing it. So this could be written as sin x. Cos x dx, you can club it as a dt term. This you can write again as a sine. Okay. So this whole thing becomes t by 1 minus t square dt. But here I have to waste my time doing one more substitution. Let's say I call it as a k. So minus 2t dt is dk. So this numerator can be written as a minus dk by k, which is again negative ln mod k plus c, which is again negative ln 1 minus t square plus c, which is again negative ln 1 minus sine square x plus c, which is again ln. There was a half factor also. Sorry about that. Yeah, so this is again ln mod sec x plus c. Okay. So many ways to get to the same result. Three ways to get to the same answer. Okay. So going forward, please put this in your formula list. Integration of tan x. Integration of tan x, note down, is ln mod sec x plus c. Before I move on to further questions, mistakes which people do, and I would like to warn you against those mistakes. Number one, and that's a very commonly seen mistake, is forgetting to substitute dx in terms of the differential of the new variable. Okay, that's number one mistake. Okay, many people have seen they will substitute the entire function in terms of the new variable, but they would not replace the dx term. Okay, that's number one. Number two mistake is keeping two variables into the same integral. So they will have a khichdi kind of a expression where there will be a t also, there will be an x also. Okay, and many of them, I don't know with what smartness, they will treat one of them as a constant with respect to the other. Okay. And they'll start solving the question. Okay. You may laugh at these mistakes, but in my teaching career, I've seen these kind of mistakes coming up. Are you getting my point? Okay. There was a student I would not like to, very long ago, I think in 2015. Okay. The question was something like this. Question was integrate x minus 2, x minus 3. Okay. So the question, the student, this is just to tickle your funny bones. The student read it as root of this. So he said, okay, root of this quadratic is 2 and 3. Correct. So he integrated 2, he integrated 3, and he gave those two as the answers. Can you imagine people doing these kind of stuff also? Okay. CBSE student doing this kind of stuff. Okay. So please don't, give these kind of shocks to your teacher in the examination hall. Root means literally she found the root of that quadratic, not the square root, the root of the equation, since both have the word root inside it. So she confused the root of that expression with finding the root of that quadratic. And she got the roots and just integrated the roots. Okay. Anyways, chalo, Anusha, what was your doubt? Which step you did not understand? Everything is evident, no, here. So from here, t dt became minus half dk. So this term became a minus half dk. This term was already a k. So 1 by k integration with respect to k is ln mod k. Minus half is already there. K was 1 minus t square. T was your sine x. So this became minus half ln cos square x plus c. Minus half means reciprocate it and take an under root, which is going to give you a sec. No, not necessarily. Aditya, not necessarily a denominator has to be taken as t. I've seen question where your numerator is also taken as a t. I'll give you a question of that set, of that sort. Okay. Please do not make those kind of extrapolation that always denominator term is substituted as a t. No. See, I will not give you any steps over here. I will just tell you the rationale behind substitution. Why do we do substitution? Whatever part of the expression you substitute, what makes you do that substitution, that is only what is important. And that rationale is converting it to a simpler integral. So any substitution which makes your problem simpler than the previous one, or a one step closer to you getting it solved, can be used. Now, it needn't be always of a term in the denominator. It could also be a term on the numerator. Okay. All right. So having continued with this, we'll also talk about integration of cortex. Okay. Cortex also, I will be saving your and my time by doing it directly. In this, unfortunately, the approach is the same. Hence, you will have a feeling that always the denominator is taken as a T. And not only that, you will realize that every time it gets converted to ln only. But no, it is all coincidence that it is happening. And it will be happening in all the four integrals that we are going to take in a few minutes time. Okay. So it's going to be ln mod sine x plus c. Please note this down. Very important result. Integration of cortex with respect to x, added to your formula list, is ln mod sine x plus c. Integration of secx. This also has a good story. Achha, by the way, I would request you to attempt this question. What is the integration of secx? First thing that you would write is 1 by cos. Okay, then what do you do from here on? Multiply and divide with sine. No, actually multiply and divide with cos. Okay. So that will make it cos x, and the denominator is cos square. Cos square is 1 minus sine square. Okay. Take sine x as a t. Okay. So cos x dx will automatically become a dt. So this will become dt by 1 minus t square. Okay. Then what do you do with this? Okay. Now all of you please pay attention. This term is actually 1 minus t into 1 plus t. Correct? Can I write it as something like this? Correct me if I'm wrong. 1 minus t by 1 plus t whole multiplied with half. Okay. This is basically breaking up into partial fractions. Okay. So once you've written it like this, you may choose to integrate this fellow. Let me take half outside. Okay. So this gives you half integration of 1 by t is ln t. So integration of 1 by a linear extrapolation will give you ln of the same term, but you have to divide by a minus 1. So you have to divide by a minus 1. So something like this will be seen. Okay. Let's regroup it. It's a half ln 1 plus sine x by 1 minus sine x. Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. But the answer that normally is given to us is a slightly different format. What they will do with this term is they will multiply this with 1 plus sine x in the numerator and denominator, so that this becomes 1 minus sine square x. Okay. And this term is 1 plus sine x by cos x the whole square. Now, please remember, the power of 2 will come in front and that will get cancelled with this 2. Okay. And this term within the ln, you divide it by cos, it will become sec x plus tan x. This is a more, you can say, commonly seen result that we use, right? We hardly use this result, half ln 1 plus sine x or 1 minus sine x. We mostly use this result, and this will be what will be mentioned in your, at the back of your exercises when you're solving a question. Okay. So please note down, this is the result for integration of sec x. By the way, there is a simpler method to achieve the whole thing. What is the simpler method? Multiply and divide with sec x plus tan x. I'm writing this as method number 2. Okay. Now take sec x plus tan x as a t or another variable. And if you differentiate it, you get sec x tan x plus secant square x dx as your dt. That is actually sitting on your numerator. See, this whole term is sitting as in your numerator as a dt. Isn't it? When you expand it, it gives you secant square, sec x tan x. That is what is present over here. Of course, dx is also there. Okay. So this whole term becomes dt by t. And this is a simpler way out, which directly gives you the result as ln mod sec x plus tan x plus c. Okay. Anyhow you do it, I mean, you have to use substitution. No way out. So substitution is heart and soul of integration. Now there are other versions of the same result. I will show you those versions also. So first note this down. Another version of this result is, where should I write it? Okay, maybe I'll write it over here. Note down. One formula is already seen. Half ln 1 plus sine x by 1 minus sine x. Another version was without half. Ln sec x plus tan x. And sec x plus tan x is reciprocal of sec x minus tan x. So you can also write it as negative ln sec x minus tan x. Okay. And there is in half angles also, which is ln mod tan pi by 4 plus x by 2. Out of these four formulas, these two are very heavily seen. Okay. So at least these two should be in your mind. Now, how do I get the last result? Very simple. Take this result. In this result, you write it everything in terms of sine cos. Okay. Use your 1 plus sine x formula is cos x by 2 plus sine x by 2 the whole square. And cos x formula is cos square x by 2 minus sine square x by 2. Okay. You may factorize the denominator as cos x by 2 plus sine x by 2 into cos x by 2 minus sine x by 2. So can I do one thing? Can I be lazy enough to just take care of that term here itself? Okay. Now divide throughout with cos x by 2. It gives you 1 plus tan x by 2 by 1 minus tan x by 2. This is clearly a formula for, or this is clearly an expression which can be written as tan of pi by 4 plus x by 2. Okay, that's how you end up getting the last formula. By the way, I'll just make some partition over here, else everything will mix with everything else. Is it fine? Any questions? So four formulas already we have seen for sec x. Similarly, without much waste of time, I'll also talk about cosecant x. The simplest approach to get integral of cosec x is multiply it with cosec x minus cot x. And and take cosecant x minus cot x as a t. So basically minus cot x minus cosec x cot x plus cosecant square x dx will become your dt. And this entire term is sitting on the numerator, so it becomes dt by t. So this is ln mod t plus c, and this result is obtained ln mod cosec x minus cot x plus c. By the way, you could have also done it in second method by writing it as 1 by sine x multiplied with sine x, and write the denominator as 1 minus cos square x. Take cos x as a t. So negative sine x dx will become a dt. So this whole thing gets converted to a dt t square minus 1. So 1 by t square minus 1 is factorizable as this. And this is nothing but 1 by t minus 1 minus 1 by t plus 1 by 2. Correct me if I'm wrong. Okay. So this is as good as integration of this term and this term subtracted. So if I'm not mistaken, it will give you ln mod t minus 1 by t plus 1. Okay. And that's nothing but one more result, half ln sine, cos x minus 1 by cos x plus 1. Within the mod, it doesn't actually matter if you switch their positions also. So even if you do ln mod 1 minus cos x by 1 plus cos x, doesn't make a difference. Okay. So yet another result. In fact, I will write all the results together. Note down in your formula list the following results. We have already derived two of them, which is this. Okay, and this is negative reciprocal. This is a reciprocal of cosec x plus cot x. So it will become negative ln cosec x plus cot x. Okay, I hope that is clear to you. Just now we figured out you could write it as half ln 1 minus cos x by 1 plus cos x also. And one more result is there, which is ln mod tan x by 2. ln mod tan x by 2. Okay, that is very obvious. When you simplify this in terms of 2 sine square x by 2, this has 2 cos square x by 2, and square square will be taken care by this half sitting outside. Okay, so before we go for a break, I will at least try to do 5 to 6 questions with you, where substitution is very, very important. And these are just the standard results which we obtained from substitution. Please, going forward, incorporate these results in solving a complicated problem. And they have to be memorized. Okay, these results have to be memorized. Up where? Up to the left or up to the right? Which part do you want to see? There? Okay. Yeah. Done. Okay. Let's take some questions based on substitutions. Okay. In fact, this topic substitution itself is very long. I mean, there are a lot of types which are based on this. Anyways, let me start with this question. Ln tan x by 2 divided by sin x. Integrate this with respect to x. No. Don't type your answer. Just say done if you're done. Okay, Shitej is done. Done. So here, if you see, you have to take your numerator as a t. Okay. So Aditya, you are asking, no, always denominator is taken as c. No. Here numerator, I will take as a t. When you differentiate it, you will end up getting 1 by 2 sine x by 2 cos x by 2 in the denominator, which is basically trying to say that dx by sin x is like your dt. So this term dx by sin x, this will behave as your dt term, whereas this will behave as your t term. So you are integrating t dt. T dt integration is t square by 2 plus c. So your answer will be half of ln of tan x by 2, the whole square plus c. Clear? Any questions? Okay. We'll show you some, challenging questions also where substitution is, very, very essential phenomena. Let's take this question. Read the question completely. I think it is asking for f of x plus g of x, not the integral directly. Okay. Anybody willing to give? Okay, so Aditya has given a response. Okay, Aditya. Chalo, we'll see this. See, if you look at the denominator term, okay, I can see some terms like cos x sitting, one sitting. Of course, exponential term is not there. So let's try doing one thing. Let's try writing in the numerator terms associated with the derivative of this term. So derivative is this term, right? So let's see what we can do. So cos x minus sin x. See, it's a leap of faith many a times. Integration is not conventional that if I apply proper product rule or proper quotient rule or chain rule, I will definitely get my answer. Please don't have that kind of a myth or a wrong notion in your mind. Okay. So integration is a chapter where many a times you will start with an approach and be prepared to fail. Okay, be prepared to fail and then again take a fresh approach. Okay, so it's not conventional. So this term that you have on the numerator, first let me write down this derivative term. Okay, let me make some addition subtraction. So e to the power, this term and this term is already there. E to the power x is not supposed to be there, so I'll remove it. Then I need to have a minus sine x and a minus x. So that also I will introduce it. So I wrote the same term in a slightly, different fashion. Now let's see what happens when I divide it by the denominator and integrate it. So this term I'll separate it. In fact, a minus sign I can separate it out. Oh, sorry, this was sign. Okay, so if you see here, you have a very, very easy integral to perform. Okay, so in this first part of the integral, in this part, if you take e to the power x plus sine x plus t, as you can see, the numerator has already been framed in such a way that this will automatically come out to be the derivative. So numerator along with dx term will become the dt term for you. And the second integral is just an integral of one with respect to x. Am I right? So this is e to the power x plus sine x plus x mod ln. Okay. Now, as per your question setter, he is asking for f of x plus g of x, where f of x is the one which has been put as an argument to log and g of x is the one which is outside. So it is very clear that f of x is this term and g of x is minus x. So if you add them, f of x plus g of x, you will end up getting option number B. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? If you want, I can write it in a clearer way so that you can have a look at it. Is it okay? Any questions? See, again, you have to be observant here. For example, I saw a few related terms like sine x already there, x already there, cos x coming from derivative of this, one coming from derivative of this. So these kind of observations based a substitution I made. Now, that's what I told. I may have failed also, Aditya. Okay. Then probably I would have thought of something else. What you see is it clicked in one go, but many a times it doesn't click in one go. So there may be several failures which led to this approach. Okay. What we see is the AIR rank. What we don't see is how many hours that person would have put in to get that AIR rank, All India rank. So what you see is like, okay, sir is able to solve it in one shot. What you don't see is how many times I would have failed when I was practicing it when I was of your age. So yes, it is something which is driven through a lot of exposure to the problems. Observation you should be good at. Okay. And yes, as you keep solving more and more questions, you will start finding that, okay, this works, this will not work. That is why many types have been created because of it. When I was preparing for my JEE, we used to be given a very thin book, Russian book called IA Meron. You may ask your parents about it. Maybe they would have also referred to the same book. Right? It's called Basic Calculus book on by IA Meron. And it had very less theory in it. It has mostly problems. So we learned mostly by problem solving. So yes, you will be exposed to more questions later on, and then you will frame a theory out of it. And that theory also is not like completely correct. It may fail also sometimes. Next, let's take this question. You would have done this problem in school also. So when you see this question, what runs in your mind? A simple statement will run in your mind. Had the expressions been added or subtracted, then I would have easily done it, right? But right now it is multiplied. And of course, using integration by parts is not going to be a simple process. It may complicate the problem even more. Right, Sitesh. Gayatri, on what? I mean, in the present form, what will you do to get that, whatever you're saying? What would be the starting process of this problem? But that was only for one tan x, right? Here, there are three tan terms multiplied. What will you do? You will extrapolate it, multiply ln ckx, ln 2c2x by 2, and ln c3x by 3, and multiply the result. That doesn't work. Formula was only for one single tan x integration, right? Yes, right, Gayatri. The starting point is, first we have to break tan 3x as tan 2x plus x. Use your basic trig identities. Okay. You yourself will see that things will get simplified and the integrand will appear in one of your terms. Okay, let's multiply the denominator to the left. By the way, let me use shorthand notation. I don't want to write too many things. Tan, who will write? What you see is your, you have tx, t2x and t3x, correct? This is what we want. That can be easily be obtained by making this the subject of the formula. Okay. So instead of integrating this, you can choose to integrate this, which is your tan 3x minus tan 2x minus tan x. Okay. So this is how you have to think out. Right? It's not I know a product rule. I will keep using it whenever I see a product. No, that doesn't work like that. You will end up complicating the scenario more. Okay. So this is reverse chain rule. I hope everybody remembers the reverse chain rule. Instead of X, you have a linear extension of X, means instead of X, you have some AX plus B kind of a thing. So you have to use a similar formula, but don't forget to divide it by this. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns here? This problem is a very famous one. It comes in school as well. Next. Power of, let's say, x 4 plus 1 to the power of 3 by 4. Just write it done if you're done with it. All these problems which I'm giving you, they are all the ones which have been asked in some of the other exams. That is why these are not like the typical questions. I will be sending you after the class a complete list of 400, 500 problems. You need not solve all the problems, but just do some chosen ones from there which you feel are, you know, tricky. Okay. Yes. How to solve this question? Very simple here. You take this x to the power 4 outside this power of 3 by 4. So it will come out as x cube. And there is an already an x square waiting over here. So that will become x to the power 5. Now, 1 by x to the power 5 appears when you differentiate this term, isn't it? Yes, solution is attached here. Solution will be attached to that. Don't worry. Yeah, so in this, you can either go for 1 minus x to the power 4 as your t, or you could make your life simpler by choosing this whole thing as a t, or many times I've seen people going for t to the power 4 also. Right? Because if you take this as t to the power 4, this 4 and the 4 in the denominator of this power will be adjusted. So there are multiple ways. Some may go just for 1 by x to the power 4 as a t. Some may go with 1 plus 1 by x to the power 4 as a t. Some may go with 1 plus 1 by x to the power 4 as t to the power 4. See, ultimately, it's your thought process. What makes your life easier, go for it. Now, differentiate both sides. Sorry. With respect to x. Or with respect to whatever variables they are in. So this 4 and this 4 will be taken care of. So as you can see, dx by x to the power 5 is negative t cube dt. So this whole term, you can write it as negative t cube dt. And down in the denominator, it's t cube. Okay. So t cube gone. And as you see, a simple integral for us to perform. Okay. Don't leave your answer in terms of the variable that you have used to solve the problem. Okay. At least in your semester two exams, when you have subjective paper, don't do that mistake. Is it fine? Any questions? Okay. Now a special type of question. I think you would have already seen this while practicing. This is, let's say, A. They all have a similar approach, so I'll just write them together, okay? And maybe I'll solve one of them, or we will solve one of them. Dx, you can put. Okay, out of ABC, let us first target A. Okay. I mean, others have a similar approach. So if you do one of them properly, we will be able to do the others as well. So how do you solve A? If you have solved it earlier, this problem is present in R.D. Sharma and all those books, then fine. If you have not solved it, let's try attempting it. Pranav is done. Shitij is also done. Okay. So in this kind of problem, the typical approach that we use is, if you have same type of term, that is sine sine or cos cos. Okay. We multiply and divide in the numerator with sine A minus B. So for both these approaches, this is the, for both these types, this is the approach. Okay, now see what I'm going to do with that sine A minus B, which I have written. So that sine A minus B on the top, you can write it as sine X minus B minus X minus A. Okay, I've just introduced an X so that it rhymes with the angles present in the denominator. Now, what is the benefit of using this? The benefit of using this is, let me just treat this as one angle. Let me call it as angle A. Let me call this as angle B. So we have sine A minus B formula, which is sine A cos B minus cos A sine B. And down in the denominator, you have sine A sine B. Okay. Just divide individually both the numerator terms by the denominator. So you'll end up getting cot X minus A. And this will give you cot X minus B. Now, these expressions are simple for us to integrate because cot X integration, we already know. This is just a linear extrapolation of that. So this is going to become ln mod sine X minus A minus ln mod sine X minus B. So this is ln mod sine X minus A by sine X minus B. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? While for the last one where you have a mix of sine and cos, in this case, we recommend multiplying with cos A minus B and then split this up again as cos x minus b minus cos x minus a. Okay, this is what we recommend for the last one. So for sine, sine, cos, cos, use sine. For sine, cos, mix, you use cos. Is it fine? Any questions, any concerns? Okay. Now we'll take a break here. On the other side of the break, we will be discussing integral of the type sine to the power mx, cos to the power nx, few of the types related to it after the break. Yeah, sure. Please do it for homework. Okay, this part you please do it for homework. Is that fine? Okay, so we'll take a break now. The time right now is 6:19. We'll meet at 6:34. Sir, yes. 35 only, sir. 35 only. No, yeah, every minute is important for us. Okay, see you in 15 minutes time. So, see, this type that we are going to take up, it is no different from method of substitution. So we are going to use substitution here also, right? But because these kind of problems have been asked so many times in these competitive exams that we make a theory out of it, right? Ultimately, it's nothing but it's a concept which is based on your understanding, or you can say your skill to substitute. That's it. Okay. Nothing unusual is going to be discussed over here. Okay. All right. Now, depending upon M and N, which is your powers of sine and cos, there are, we normally have broken down this theory into four cases. Okay. So first case is where your M and N are odd natural numbers. Okay, M and N are odd natural numbers. Okay, or odd numbers. Odd natural numbers. So in such case, what do? The approach is, algorithm is, again, this algorithm has been derived because of the, you can say, the normal pattern that we have seen to solve this question. Okay. So what do? We take the term, substitute that trigonometric ratio to be t, which is subjected to the higher odd power, Now in reality, you can substitute any one of the two as a t and solve it. Okay. So once you substitute that, see what will happen. Let me not write it as a, because this is the only step that we do. Let me explain it by an example. Let's say somebody has given you to integrate sine to the power of 5x into cos cube x. Okay. Out of the two, you can see 5 is the higher odd power, correct? So I will substitute sine x as a t. So trigonometric ratio means sine or cos, whichever. Okay. So when you substitute sine x as a t, cos x dx will become a dt. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to borrow a cos x from the cos cube term. Okay. And I'm now going to use my t consistently throughout. This will become t to the power 5. This will become 1 minus t square. And this will become dt, right? This will become a dt term. Now, this is simple to integrate. We can easily integrate t to the power 5 minus t to the power 7. Correct? So this is simple. T to the power 6 by 6 minus t to the power 8 by 8. And put your t back in terms of sine. So sine to the power 6 x by 6. Sine to the power 8 x by 8. Now, I could have also substituted cos x and solved this problem. right? So you can also substitute cos x into this problem, but in the other case, you'll end up getting 1 minus sine square square. So ultimately, you will have to, you know, expand a slightly, you can say, lengthier term to do. Okay. See, I could also substitute cos x as a t. So in that case, minus sine x dx will become a dt. So what I will do is I will borrow a sine term from here. In fact, borrow a negative sine x and put a negative sign outside. So this term will become 1 minus cos square square. So it's 1 minus t square square. Okay. And this is dt. So ultimately, you'll have to first, you know, expand this, multiply with t cube, and then write a term and then find its integration. So this also can be used, but slightly lengthy. That is why we recommend substituting the term which has got a higher odd power, okay, as a t. Is it fine? Now, in my time, we were never told these kind of theories. So this theory has come because we have seen this type of problem, and normally people do this, and that's why it has become a theory. Next, case number 2. Any questions that you have here, please do let me know. Case number 2 is where one of m or n is odd natural number. And other is even natural number. Okay. In such cases, the algo says, substitute the trigonometric ratios subjected to even natural number power as t. Okay. Let's take an example. Let's say I take sine cube x and cos to the power 6 x. Okay. So one of them is even, another is odd. So this is odd, this is even. So the one which is subjected to even power, that will be substituted as a t. Okay. So here you borrow one's negative sine x. So you'll be left with something like this. Okay. And take this expression in terms of t. Okay. So this is a simple integration, t to the power 8 minus t to the power 6. And this is a simple power rule of integration. We already know this result. And put your t back as your cos x. Is this fine? Even if this theory was not known, you would have come to know it by trial and error. Now, what will be the problem if you substitute sine x as a t? If you substitute sine x as a t, then you will be left with a cos to the power 5x, because one cos x will go in dt. And then cos to the power 5, if you want to express in terms of sine, you'll have to use fractional powers and all, and that will create a lot of issues. Okay, that will create a lot of issues. Okay, so let's follow this to save our time and effort. So the one which has got even natural number as its power, substitute that as a t, whichever of the two. That depends on question to question. Can we move on to case number 3 now? Case number 3 is when both of them are even. When both m and n are even natural numbers. So here there are two approaches. One is by the use of trigonometric ratios and identities. Okay, and another is by use of complex numbers. However, both of them achieve the same purpose. Okay, complex number to be more precise, by use of De Moivre's theorem. De Moivre's theorem. both the approaches have the same objective. Now, what is the objective? The objective is to convert higher powers to multiple of the angles. What is the objective? I'll repeat once again. The objective in this kind of a problem is to convert a higher power into multiple of the angles. Okay. How it is achieved or how these two methods are, you know, implemented to achieve that. Let's start with a question. Maybe the question will be a good example to talk about it. Let's say I want to integrate sine square into cos to the power 4. Okay. Now, you think, neutrally you think, how would you integrate this? Will you substitute sine x as a t? If you do that, you will get cos cube term, and cos cube term will be, you know, creating a fractional power. Same will be true even if you put cos x as a t, isn't it? Correct? So what will you do here? So for here, we will try to convert it to multiple of the angles. Yes. So how do I do that? Simple. All of you, please pay attention. First of all, I'll club some sine square and cos square term and make it as So I'm using my trig identities, TRI for it. Okay, then I'll come to the complex number approach and we'll see which is more, you know, beneficial to us. This is as good as a sine square 2x. Okay. Now we convert sine square 2x into 1 minus cos 4x by 2. And this has 1 plus cos 2x by 2. So slowly you are converting it to higher multiples of angles. Okay. Power has been getting changed to multiple of angles. So this will be 1 by 16. Correct me if I'm wrong. This will give you 1 plus cos 2x minus cos 4x minus cos 4x 2x. Okay. Now this also you provide it with a 2. Okay, use your transformation formula. If I'm not mistaken, this is cos 6x plus cos 2x. Okay, so overall, if you see, it will become something like this. 1 plus half cos 2x minus cos 4x minus half cos 6x. Now you finally integrate this, because now it is in the format where you can integrate. This will become sine 2x by 4. This will become sine 4x by 4. This will become sine 6x by 12 plus a c. Okay, I'm not simplifying it any further. Okay, this is your answer. Now you realize that this takes in a bit of your time, especially while you are, you know, you are wasting a lot of time while you are writing sine, cos, and etc. So three alphabets, you know, you have to write for every trigonometric ratio. That takes away a bit of your time. Okay. The same thing can be achieved by using our de Moivre's theorem. Now, how? Let us try to see that. Okay, by the way, any question related to this approach, do let me know. Clear? Any questions? Any questions, concerns, do let me know. Okay. By de Moivre's theorem, first of all, let us recall the de Moivre's theorem. Let us say if you take a complex number, cos x plus I sine x. Okay, let's say I call it as a z. We all know that z to the power n, n being some integer, will give you cos nx plus I sine nx, correct? And if I raise the same to power of minus n, it'll give you cos nx minus I sine nx, okay? I'm just revisiting a bit of theory before I start applying it. In other words, z to the power n plus 1 by z to the power n, we all know it's 2 cos nx. And z to the power n minus 1 by z to the power n, in fact, 1 by 2i, this is nothing but, in fact, 1 by I, I should say. Or you can say 2i also, no issues. This will be sine nx, isn't it? Okay. Let me just take the two here as well, so as to maintain a consistency in the way I've written them. Yeah. Okay, so we are going to use this. How? Let's check. So let us look at the integrand first. Okay, please note that this doesn't help you to integrate. This just simplifies it to a form which you can integrate. That means it converts it to multiple of angles. I'm repeating once again, De Moivre's theorem doesn't help you to integrate. It basically converts your integrand into a simpler expression, or you can say a power of power is getting converted to multiple of angles, which is relatively easier for us to integrate. Please understand this. Okay. So now sine square x from here, can I do one thing? Can I put n as a 1 over here? Okay, if you put n as 1 over here, I'll get sine x from the second term. So it'll be 1 by 2y z minus 1 by z. Z minus 1 by z whole square. And similarly, cos x from here, I'll do one thing. I'll put n as 1 and I will just take a power of 4. Is this expression clear to everybody? Any questions? Anybody has any issue with this expression, do let me know. Okay. So this becomes 1 by 64, z minus 1 by z square. Okay. And this becomes z plus 1 by z to the power 4. Now, all of you, please pay attention. Your problem will be solved in very quick time. See, if you can write this as z square minus 1 by z square whole square, can I write it like this? In fact, you have to write less in this form. Okay. So this is 1 by 64. This is z to the power 4, 1 by z to the power 4 minus 2. This is z square 1 by z square plus 2. Okay. Now, this expression that you have and this expression that you have, if you read it in light of this term, if I put z as a 4, can I say 1 by 2 z to the power 4, 1 by z to the power 4 is actually cos 4x, correct? That means z to the power 4, I'll write it here itself. That means z to the power 4, 1 by z to the power 4 is 2 cos 4x. Okay. So in short, what we can do is we can write this term as 2 cos 4x. Minus 2 will remain minus 2. Similarly, this will become 2 cos 2x. Okay. And you can just do away with this 2, 2, 2, 2. Put a 1, 1, and that will give you a 16 over here. Okay. You can also switch the position of this 1 minus cos 4x. If you see very closely, you have actually reached this step. Yeah, there you go. This one. Yeah. So 1 by 16, 1 minus cos 4x, 1 plus cos 2x. But we're writing very less actually. Okay. You don't have to write cos, sine, like that. Okay. After that, you can just, you know, follow your regular mechanism, the one which you have already done in these steps. Okay. So you have already reached this step. So I'll just directly jump to the final step. So from here, you can write it as 1 by 16. This will be nothing but 1 plus cos 2x minus cos 4x And I think it was half cos 6x plus cos 2x. Okay. I hope I've written everything properly. Check it out. Or this was minus n. Yeah. So, I mean, after this, you know how to integrate it. So please do so. So once you have done this, you can make your integration faster. You can just do your integration here itself. Now you will understand the efficacy of this method when the power is slightly higher, where your trigonometric ratio will take much longer time. And this method will take a slightly lesser time. For example, let's take a question. You'll realize the efficacy of this method when I take a heavier power. Is this fine? Any question with respect to this? I'm not integrating this. I hope you can integrate it from here on. So I've written proceed here. Let's take a question which has got a higher power. Let's say I want to integrate. Anybody who wants to copy this, please do so. Then I will move on to the next slide. You can skip that step, Aditya. Why to write all those things? Directly write cos x as half of x plus 1 by x. Oh, sorry. Half of z plus 1 by z. And sin x as 1 by 2i z minus 1 by z. No need to write everything down. See, let's say I want to do this question. Cos to the power 10x integration. Let's say. Okay. Now imagine you doing this problem by using trig substitution. How will you do it? Anybody has any idea how to do it? You will do cos square 5. Then you will write it as 1 plus cos 2x by 2 to the power 5. And then you will raise this to the power 5 and oh my God, 6 terms will come out. This will be a tough task, correct? It will be a tough task to solve this by trigonometric ratios and identities. See, I'm not trying to showcase the importance of one over the other. Both have their own importance. For lighter powers, trigonometric ratio is good enough. No need to go for complex number approach. But for this case, you can directly substitute cos x as half of z plus 1 by z. Okay. And see how fast it will be. When you raise it to the power 10, it becomes 1 by 2 to the power 10. 1 by 2 to the power 10 is this. Now see how beautifully the terms will come over here when you raise this to the power of 10. All of you, please pay attention. Z to the power 10 will come and the last term will be 1 by z to the power 10. Check it out. First term will be z to the power 10 and the last term will also be 1 by z to the power 10. Okay. Then 10c1. Next term will be z to the power 8 and the second last term will be also 10 by z to the power 8. So they will automatically pair up like this. That means always you will get a term of this nature so that you can directly use this formula and convert it to multiple angles. This will always come out, always guarantee. Okay. Next term will be 45 z to the power 6 and 45 divided by z to the power 6. So you can club it up like this. Okay. So this is 10c1, 10c2. 10c3 is 120. I hope you all remember your 10c values. Okay. Then 10c, this is 10c1, 10c2, 10c3, 10c4. 10c4 is 210, if I'm not mistaken. Okay. And 10c... 5 is 252, right? So see the benefit of this method. Only you write this step and the next step is your conversion into multiple angles. So this is 2 cos 10x. Done. This is 20 cos 8x. Now this is already in the format which you can integrate. This is 90 cos 6x. This is 240 cos 4x. I know some heavy coefficients are coming, but that is not my concern right now. Okay, so once you have written cos to the power 10x like this, you can go for the integration, right? So let's do it. I mean, since we have brought it to so far, So this will be 2 sine 10 x by 10, 20 sine 8 x by 8, 90 sine 6 x by 6. Of course, you can do a lot of cancellation, which I'm not interested in doing because my purpose is not to teach you simplification. My purpose is just to highlight how efficient this method could be in such cases. Is it fine? This is your answer. Any questions, any concerns, do let me know. Yes, why not? Yes. If you picked up for that, you will end up getting stuck. Right. Try it out, Ashutosh. You may try out using it. Let's see what implications it has when you use it for other forms. That's a good question actually you asked. Okay, finally, the fourth case, which I'll be discussing here, when your M and N are rational numbers, which add up to a negative even integer. Okay. It happens mostly in the case where your powers M and N are, you know, fractions, negative fractions. I'll just take a example for the same and I'll tell you the algorithm also. Let's say I take this question, sine to the power of minus 5 by 3x, and let's say cos to the power of minus 1 by 3x. Okay. So in this type of question, first of all, any kind of a negative power, we take it to the denominator. So I'll go here is, okay, take negative power terms to the denominator. Okay. And then let's say this negative integer is minus 2k. Then divide your numerator and denominator by cos to the power of 2k. Okay, and then everything will convert into tan. So take tan x as a t. Okay, let's demonstrate this algo on this expression. So here both are negative powers. So I'll write it like this. Oh, first of all, m is minus, let's say this, and n is minus 1 by 3. Do they add up to give us a negative integer? Yes. Negative even integer? Yes. Negative even integer is minus 2 in this case, right? So your 2k is your 2k is your 2. Okay, as per my expression. Okay. Again, these things have been, you know, unnecessarily theorized. I will use the word theorized. We never learned this when we learned the hard way. Okay, when we used to do this, okay, then next step should be this, and let's try dividing it by some cost. And then, I mean, later on, it was made into theory. So now you divide your numerator and denominator by cos square. Now this minus 2 means you have to divide by cos square. So both numerator and denominator, you have to divide by cos square. Okay. So this will become secant square on the top. Down in the denominator, if you see, you will always get tan of the same power as that is on sine. Check it out. See, 1 by 3 and 2, that will compensate to give you cos 5 by 3. And sine 5 by 3, cos 5 by 3 will give you tan 5 by 3. Now, we have reached this step. We have divided the numerator and denominator by cos to the power of 2kx. Now, take tan x as a t. So, tan x as a t, if you take, you will end up getting secant square x dx dt. So this is dt by t to the power 5 by 3. And this is a simple, you can say, power rule of integration, which you can, you know, easily solve. Okay. Any questions? One more question we'll take on this type, and then we'll move on to our standard integrals or special integrals. That is the important thing, because most of your problems are based on that only. So one question only I will take it. Take care. See, I normally love to do a lot of integration question, but you know, we are having a time crunch also because board has come in between all of a sudden. We want to cover as much as possible before the boards. You know why? Because till December, you will not learn anything. You will not want to learn anything. So that will be a, you know, dead hours for us. Just say done if you are done, okay? Done. So m plus n here is, I think, minus 20 by 5, which is actually minus 4, a negative even digit. So as I told you, if it is in the negative power, bring it to the denominator like this. Okay. And divide both your numerator and denominator by cos to the power of whatever is this negative integer. Remove the negative sign and raise it on cos. That is cos to the power 4x. So this is sec to the power 4x dx. Down in the denominator, you can save your time and directly write tan to the power 7 by 5x. Okay, it'll always come like that. Trust me. It's obvious why it comes like that. I don't have to explain that. Okay, so now, this one of the sec to the power 4, you keep it as sec square, and other you write it as 1 plus tan square. Okay. Now take your tan x as a t. So secant square x dx will become your dt. So this will become 1 plus t square dt by t to the power 7 by 5. Correct? Now, I don't think so. I have to, you know, tell you any further how to integrate this, because I think all of you are experienced enough to integrate this. Okay. So please use power rule and proceed. Achha, many times I will write proceed because I don't want to save the entire time doing the simple integration, but this is something which I would like to share with you, my own story. When I was preparing for my JEE, after integration was over, I was given almost around 1000 questions by my coaching institute to solve. So 1000 question is like, you know, if you calculate almost 3 minutes also per question, that is 3000 minutes, almost. How many 50 hours of work was given to me? And 50 hours of work, I had to complete it within, let's say, 2 to 3 weeks. So what I used to do is I used to solve a question. And after I reach a stage where I knew how to solve it, I used to abandon the question. That, okay, I have now reached this stage. Chalo, I know how to do it from here on. Leave it. Let's move on to the next question. What happened in due course of time, I started forgetting the formula only. What formula? You'll come to see some formula a little later on in our today's discussion also. So don't do that mistake which I did. So please, as far as possible, of course, when it is very simple step, you can skip it. You can go to the next question. Don't have to do it. But once you reach a step where you feel that there is a formula required over here, which I may forget in long run, then please do that problem to the end till you write that plus C. Okay, this is my sincere request to everybody. Okay, it happened with me, and when I went to the examination room, I could bring it to the final form, which, you know, the result was already given to us, and I forgot the result because I was not writing it. I always used to like, okay, from here I could do it, so leave it. So I was not writing it. I ended up forgetting it. And of course, I had to sit and derive it, but that wasted my time, no? Okay. So of course, you know how to do power rule of integration, that you can leave it. But when you have a formula to be applied, that okay, after this, there is a formula already there to do it. There you do it to the completion. Okay. And those formulas are now going to start appearing for you as well. So now we are going to talk about some standard integrals, also called as some special integrals. Okay. Whose results we'll be deriving also. Let us do it in this coming 9 minutes. Oh, sorry, 21 minutes. I should be done with that. So these standard six results that you should be well versed with. The first one is this result. Second is this result. Some of them I've already taken in the beginning of our today's discussion. Fourth one is this. So there are six of them. Yes, six of them, they will come in various shapes and sizes in the question that you will be solving. So be aware of them. I mean, know their results on your fingertips. Okay. So what are the results of this? So this also is actually under substitution only. Okay. I will be solving all these by using substitution, but yes, trigonometric substitution. Like the way you learned in your differentiation chapter. Okay. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to derive each one of these six results one by one in the next page. And I'm going to come back and put the result over here. I don't want to corrupt this page. Okay. So first one, dx by x square plus a square. You will only suggest what integration, what substitution can I use here? Please suggest a substitution for me. Any trick substitution that will help you here? X as a tan theta, right? So, let's save our time and energy because you would have already done this in your school as well, just for the purpose of completion of our understanding. So, this will denominator will give you a square sec square theta. Okay. And there will be nothing left other than 1 by a. So, this is 1 by a theta plus c. And what is theta? Theta is tan inverse of x by a. So, this result is there. Now, many people will say, sir, why substitution and all? Okay, you can use this method also, second method. You can take a 1 by a square common out and you can write it like this. Okay. Now, recall that we had already done 1 by 1 plus x square in our formula list. And that was tan inverse x, isn't it? So, this is just a linear extension of that. So can I not write this answer as 1 by a square tan inverse of x by a divided by 1 by a, that means divided by the coefficient of x. Okay. Yes, this also can be done and you'll end up getting the same result. Okay. Another method to look at the same thing. Okay. In school, you all derived it, no? Just asking, I mean, so that I can be fast. Okay. Shitish has confirmed. Yes. Gayatri also confirmed. Yes. Aditya also confirmed. Yes. Okay. Next one. Second one. Let's do it. Here itself, I will do it. I don't have to use another page for it. Here again, you can go for a substitution x as a sec theta or cosec theta. But the best way to solve this question is by using of partial fractions, the way I did it in one of the questions before. The best way to solve it is by the use of partial fractions. So you can write it like this: 1 by x minus a minus 1 by x plus a by 1 by 2a. Okay. So instead of integrating this, you can integrate this way. Okay. So this gives you 1 by 2a ln mod x minus a minus ln x plus a. But can I combine it like this and save my time and energy? This bracket was now not required. Okay, so there you go. This is the result for the second integral. I'll go and just jot it down over here. Okay, 1 by 2a ln, 1 by 2a ln mod x minus a by x plus a. Okay, acha, the second, third result is actually negative of this, right? So what we can do is we can put a negative and we can reciprocate this. But when you're reciprocating it, we normally reciprocate it like this. Now many people say, sir, Q, why? We could have just written it as x plus a by x minus a. See, there's no other reason, but just the reason that it resembles 1 by a tan hyperbolic inverse x by, that's it. There's no other reason for writing it as a plus x by a minus x. But because when you write it in this form, it resembles 1 by a tan hyperbolic inverse x by, that's it. Okay, that's the whole and sole purpose of writing it as a plus x by a minus x. Within mod, you can do any kind of changes. Okay, coming to the fourth one. Fourth one also, let us derive it. Let us derive it. This page itself is good enough for deriving the fourth one. Yeah, let's have this place. So under root of x square plus a square, here also you can go for the substitution x is equal to a tan theta. So numerator will become a secant square theta d theta. Denominator will become a sec theta. I hope I'm not fast here. Ultimately leaving you with sec theta. Okay, sec theta is ln mod sec theta plus tan theta. Okay, and put your x back. So this will become tan theta will become x by a, and this will become under root of 1 plus x square by a square. Correct. Now here, if you take the LCM of your a, you will end up getting x plus under root x square plus a square whole divided by a plus c. But normally what do? Is we write it like this. We write it as ln mod x plus under root x square plus a square, and minus ln a plus c is clubbed under another c. That means isko hum log alag se c bolte hain, right? We call it as another constant of integration. Okay. So this is how you end up getting the result for the fourth one. By the way, if you remember, this was actually sine hyperbolic inverse x by a. Okay, this is sine hyperbolic inverse x by a, this term. Okay. I think the other derivation also you can do very easily. Same result will come, sec theta, but there you will substitute x as a sec theta. So please try this out. Only difference is you will end up getting minus sign here. The same expression will come over here. Okay. Sixth one is super easy. Sixth one is you can substitute x as, let me find a place. I may be appearing to do it very quickly because I want to save your time and my time also, because you have already done it in school. Okay. This also will give you a cos theta only. So nothing is left other than theta. So this will give you theta plus c, and theta is nothing but sine inverse of x by. Okay. Anybody needs more clarity, please feel free to stop me. Okay. I will be more than happy to take this up on a slightly lesser pace. Okay. This sixth result should be by hearted. Okay. By hearted, because you will be using it. And what I used to do is, let's say I reach this stage, I used to think, okay, I know the result. And ultimately, I in the exam, I was like confused. Was it ln or was it 1 by 2a ln or was it what? So that kind of a confusion, in order to avoid that, please ensure you are solving the problem to completion, at least the one which involves these. Okay. Let's take few problems based on the same. First of all, I will check your trigonometric substitution skills. Okay. I would like everybody to solve a question. Sine hyperbolic inverse x, right? This is cos hyper. This comes from cos hyperbolic inverse x by a plus c. This is not exactly cos until unless you have an x by a. Yeah. Correct. Shitij. Let's take a question where I would test you on your substitution skills. I would request everybody to solve this question. Done. Stuck. Come on. This was easy. I mean, of course. Done. Okay. See, this is actually nothing but x plus 1 the whole square plus 1 the whole square, correct? Now, for such cases, I will prefer taking x plus 1 as a tan theta, correct? So, dx is secant square theta d theta, secant square theta d theta, and this is 1 plus tan square, 1 plus tan square is sec square whole square. Okay, so ultimately it gives you cos square theta to integrate. And cos square theta, you can write it as 1 plus cos 2 theta by 2. So your answer will be half theta plus sine 2 theta by 2. Yes, of course, you have to convert things back in terms of x. So that's also not a big ask, actually, because theta is tan inverse of x plus 1. And sine 2 theta is what? Sine 2 theta is 2 tan theta by 1 plus tan square theta. So half into this will give you tan theta, which is x plus 1 by 1 plus x plus 1 the whole square. By the way, this term is actually x square plus 2x plus 1. So why to write it in a fancy way? Okay. So this is how trigonometric substitution can be useful, not only to solve those standard integrals, but also in any such cases which you feel that, oh, here I can go for a trig substitution. So trig substitution, very, very essential tool in your hand, not only in differentiation chapter, but also in integration. And of course, you have already experienced it in your inverse trig functions. Okay, now questions in general, which is based on the standard integrals that we have done. First, let me start with some basic ones just to give everybody. Let's take a question. Let's integrate this. One by under root of 1 - 4x - 2x². Shitej is done. Okay. How about others? Okay. Now here, why I chose this problem, because I've seen some people doing this blunder. I would not call that mistake. I'll call it as a blunder. Some people take -2 outside. Yeah? Don't do that. There was a student who did this last year. He took it as a -√2 outside, just to, you know, do away with the negative sign. Please note that when it is under root, only thing that you can take out is a positive quantity. 2, if you want to take out as a √2, you're welcome to do that. But don't take a -2 outside, please. People do this in your school papers. And then they'll come and say, sir, I lost mark. I did this. A very small, silly mistake that they will call it as. Not a silly mistake. It's a conceptual blunder. Okay. So if you want to take a 2 outside, you can do it. I mean, I'm not denying it, even though that is also not required. But if you want to, you can do that. Okay. So once you get this, you need to convert it to a square inside the under root sign so that you can use one of the standard integrals that you have already seen. So this is x + 1 the whole square. Okay. By the way, this will generate a -2. Okay, so make it as a 3/2. Correct? Any questions? This 3/2, you make it as √3/2². Right? Now, what does it resemble? It is basically resembling dx by √a² - x². Correct? That is already known to us, sine inverse x by. So I can write this as 1/√2 sine inverse x by a. X by a. A is going to be this. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? No, I will not be bothering you with too many questions of this. I will directly, I know, go to those questions where the question is not directly of this form, but you can make it in this form by using some substitution. So let's take this question. Please try this out. Sec x minus 1. If you're done, let me know with the done on the chat box. Dun, 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 dun. So what is going on in school nowadays? Anyone representative from Kormangla? Anyone from YPR? Anyone from DPS? Anyone from HSR? Revision. Okay. Integration continued. Okay. Gayatri, your teacher is smart. He is not wasting time. Finish differential equations. Ayyo, Rama Krishna. You started with undergraduate also. Ayyo. What so much hurry they are in. Finish differential equations. What are they going to do for the next 6 months? Revision. See, there are two types of teachers, I'll tell you. One who will do a chapter properly. I mean, they'll take time, but they'll do it properly. One who will complete it early and do multiple revisions. Okay. I feel the one who does multiple revisions, slowly people will stop coming to the classes only because they will be bored of those revisions. Okay. Done, Pranav. Finish probability. So, yeah, integration and all is over, Pranav, in HSR. Differential equation, area under curves. Okay. Not differential equation. I don't know. I'm speechless. Okay, let's solve this question. So first of all, let's write it as this. So this is under root of 1 minus cos x by cos x. Now see what I'm going to do here is multiply and divide with 1 plus cos x just to create a sin x and facilitate substitution of cos x as t. There you go. Okay. So far, so good. No problem. Now here, go for the substitution cos x as a t. So negative sin x dx will become a dt. So this will become negative dt by under root of t 1 plus t. Okay. So this will become negative dt t square plus t. Now we can now proceed from here on. By converting it to a perfect square. Again, please ensure you are solving a question completely. Don't do skipping of steps, else you will forget the formula in the long run. Okay. So this is negative ln. Now here your x role is being played by t plus half. So it's x plus under root of, now you could write the same expression or you could just write a t square plus t also, because ultimately when you write t plus half the whole square minus half square, it's actually t square plus t only. So it has come from this term only, no? So don't waste your time writing it like this and then converting it to t. Just save your time. And of course, your t has to be substituted back as cos x. Cos of x. Okay, so we will stop here. And next class, we'll be continuing with more such tweaked version questions on this special or standard integrals. And I'll also be talking about several forms, at least 5-6 forms I will tell you how to, you know, and all of them will be based out of this only, okay, more or less whatever we have done. And let's see whether we are able to start with integration by parts in the next session. I'm doubtful, but I will try my best.